Hi, welcome back. In our next section, or really our next unit, we're going to be exploring some of the principles of probability and the ideas and formulas attached to probability, which is going to help us later make the leap from the data that we have to understanding the probability of how we can apply that to a larger population. So, let's first talk about a probability experiment or trial. A probability experiment or trial are those type of things that you have been probably used to seeing in your own life where a decision needs to be made, and so you decide to flip a coin or roll the die, because we all understand that process or trial to be random. So an experiment or trial is a process in which our outcome is randomly decided, whether it's flipping of a coin, rolling of a die, or drawing a raffle ticket out of a hat. All of these have outcomes that we cannot predict in the future, and so we call those probability experiments or trials. Some other vocabulary that you want to get familiar with and that you will see in the book as you read, and I want to emphasize as you guys are reading through these PowerPoint slides and watching the videos, that especially in this section, you are also reading through the book, doing the little exercises that come along, which are going to reinforce all of these vocabulary words and principles that we're laying out here. The two are really meant to go together. So some vocabulary words, let's start with the word outcome. Outcome is a listing of every possible result that is possible when we do a probability experiment or trial. The collection of all of those outcomes is what we call our sample space. And usually, from that sample space, we deem some of those outcomes as being more desirable than others, right? And so if, for example, I have bidded on heads in the flipping of a coin, that would be my event. That's what I want to happen. So think of the event as a subset, a smaller set of my overall sample space. So we have our sample space. If I'm flipping a coin, that would consist of heads or tails. That's a collection of every possible result. The event in there, if I've voted for heads, is the heads. That's the subset of my overall sample space. If we roll a die, our sample space would be the outcomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. I want you to notice, and you're going to notice this in the book as well, that when we put those outcomes into a quote-unquote set, we use these little brackets on either side. These brackets denote sets. Sets of numbers are just collections of numbers. Order is not really important. It's kind of like throwing these things into a bag whenever we see these symbols. Those are the symbols we use for set notation. Now, if my event is rolling an odd number, the collection of outcomes that would comprise that event are the numbers 1, 3, and 5. So sample space, event space. Sometimes our sample space can get fairly large really quickly. Instead of just rolling one die, if we roll two die, now there are a lot more outcomes possible. We treat each die as an independent event. So as we look at the total possible outcomes, it comprises 36 events. So if we were to list all these out, put them into brackets, this would be my sample space. If my event is rolling doubles, we can look at this and see, okay, well, here are my doubles going diagonally across here. So those pairings of dice are my event space. When we have these multiple events occurring, for example, we're rolling not just one die, but we're rolling two die, so there's really two trials occurring there, or we're flipping a coin not just once, but let's say three times. To be able to track what our sample space is made up of, one of the helpful tools we can use is a tree diagram. A experiment consists of several stages, so we're rolling one die or we're rolling two die. We can draw a diagram to help us figure out what our sample space is made of. So for example, if I'm tossing a coin three times and I want to write out what the sample space is, for the first toss there are two possible outcomes. So I draw two branches off of this starting point and I put what the two outcomes are for that stage. And then at the next stage we build off from the previous stage. So on my second toss I have two more possible outcomes. And then for my third toss, we branch off from each one of those. I actually have a map here that is a path to every possible outcome for my sample space. My sample space consists of each one of these paths. So for example, heads, heads, heads is one of my first listed paths here, or outcomes. And that's made up of this path. But then I could also go heads, heads, tails. So that's the next one I list, so on and so forth. What we find is at the end of each branch is the end of a trail. And so each of these ends is the end of one of the possible results. And so I have eight possible results, and we can list them all here. And when we list them like this, we want to think of them as being in order. So heads, 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 we interpret as meaning heads on the first toss, heads on the second toss, heads on the third toss. So each one of these is written in order. That's an important distinction to make, because if order was not important in this notation, then this would be the same outcome as this, right? Both of them are two heads and one tails. The difference between those outcomes is when that tails came into being. And for this first one, the tails toss came at the third toss. Here, the tails toss came at the second toss of the coin. So in this type of notation, the order is significant and has meaning to it. Now when we talk about the probability of an event occurring, the idea of probability is not to predict what will happen, but what might happen, right? So for example, I have here, if we're flipping a coin, the probability of getting a heads is 50%. So if we flip a coin 10 times then, the question is, how many times will it come up heads? Well, that's a difficult thing to say, because in reality, if we toss a coin 10 times, it could come up heads 6 times, it could come up heads 8 times, it could come up heads all 10 times, right? So the probability of 50% does not tell me that if I flip a coin 10 times, it's going to come up heads 5 times. In fact, it probably won't come up 5 times. So what does that 50% probability really mean then? Well, the probability of an event is not what is going to happen in the short term, but rather what the behavior will be of your outcomes over long periods of time and repetition. As we toss a coin 100 times, it's going to get closer and closer to that 50 mark. But it may be 56 times, say, it comes up heads. Well, that means empirically there's a 56% probability. But we know that's simply based on trial. If I did it 1,000 times, it's going to get closer and closer to that 50. Maybe in that, out of those 1,000 times, we might get 512 heads, right? And so now my probability is at 51.2%. The longer and longer I continue to flip that coin, what we're going to see is that over the long run, that probability is going to quickly and quickly approach that 50% mark. So probability is not a prediction of what will occur, but rather what's going to happen over the long time and repetition. In your book, as you're reading through, there's a great applet that's actually going to allow you to flip a coin. Of course, it's just a randomly generated outcome, but you can see that this process play itself out. So it's a great little outlet that'll give you a applet that'll give you a demonstration of this idea. When we determine probability, there's three different types. First is this idea of subjective probability. A subjective probability is basically an educated guess, right? And the reliability of it is subject to the expertise of the guesser. A great example of this is weather predictions. I'm sitting here by the window right now, and I'm looking outside, and about a week ago, the prediction for today's weather was rain. But there isn't a drop of rain in the sky that I can see as I'm recording this. But sometimes the weather predictions are accurate, right? They're very hard to make, and so generally we subject them to the expertise of the guesser. Those would be examples of subjective probability. Economic predictions are very much the same. Sometimes weather predictions can be more accurate than economic predictions. All right, then we also have empirical probability. This is found by experiments. So an example of that would be flipping a coin 10 times to determine what the probability is that we're going to get heads. So the empirical probability is based on the outcomes when we do a probability experiment. So when we do a probability experiment, the number of times that we actually get heads, right? So the number of times that our event E actually occurs, we divide it by the total number of repetitions. So this is not a great way to come up with probability of actual trials or experiments. However, empirical probability is used a lot of times. For example, you're going to read through your book about determining what the probability of somebody's blood type is, right? The only way that they could determine what the probability of somebody's blood type is to look at a bunch of samples of people's bloods and then determine within the population what percent of them actually have type O, what percent have type A, etc., etc. So empirical probability is used for us to look at samples and generalize for our population. All right, classical probability is what our main focus is going to be in this section. And classical probability is simply based on theoretical, and it's based on how many event outcomes there are, which ones we deem to be desirable, and then our sample space, how many outcomes are possible. This is classical probability. For most experiments, it's impractical to do enough repetitions to determine probability, but for some information, empirical repetitions are the only way to determine probability. And here's the example of the blood type of the overall population. It's impossible to know this without random sampling. So what we do is we go out and we collect blood from people, and we test what type of blood people have. So empirical methods use a series of trials that produce outcomes that cannot be predicted in advance. We don't know what people's blood type was out there until we started looking at it and analyzing it. Classical probability a lot of times can come down to a single formula. If we can know how many outcomes of an event there are and how many outcomes are in the sample space, the probability of any event will always be the number of outcomes divided by the number of items in your sample space, and that's what this notation here is relating. So it's taking this, just putting it into a simple formula. So just a quick example, flipping a coin, what's the probability of getting a heads? So we define our event H as being the event of a heads on a toss, single toss. And the probability of H, P of H, is the way of writing out probability of H. It's going to be the number of ways we can get heads, which there's only one, and there's two sides to a coin, so the number of possible outcomes in my sample space is 2. Therefore, the probability of getting heads is 1 out of 2, or 50%. What is the probability of selecting a card at random from a deck of cards that is a heart? All right, so when we look at a deck of cards, we know that there are how many hearts in a deck of cards? Well, there's 4 suits, and those suits range in value from the ace all the way up to the king. And so there are 13 hearts in a deck of cards, and the number of cards that are in a deck of cards is 52. So my probability of getting hearts is 13 over 52, which reduces down to 1/4, which is 25%, or 0.25. All three of these are acceptable ways to represent probability. We can represent it as a fraction, we can represent it as a decimal, or we can represent it as a percentage. A lot of times you're probably used to seeing percentage. It's probably the most common way of expressing probability. Going back to our flipping of a coin three times. So our trial, in this case, is flipping a coin three times. So we're interested in knowing what's the probability that we're going to get three heads in a row. So, as with all probability, it's really made up of how many ways can we be successful divided by how many outcomes are possible. As we look at the sample space, we look at our tree diagram here and our sample space that we get from that, we see that in this, there's only one path that successfully leads us to getting all three heads. And so there's one outcome out of the eight possible outcomes that result in a successful outcome. So the probability of getting heads, heads, heads is 1 out of 8, or 0.125, 12.5%. Now our formulas for probability are going to get a little more complicated, but always keep in mind that almost every probability could come down to looking at the sample space and looking at the outcomes that are possible. It's that simple.